Hello friends, in this session we are going to talk about something very interesting which we actually taught the fundamentals for this in the earlier session. We are going to see about pipelining and data path. In my earlier sessions, I spoke to you about what is pipelining, what are all the hazards available there, what is a control hazard, what is a data hazard, what exactly is the structural hazard, etc. Also, I spoke to you about the prediction, which means branch prediction, and the techniques which can help you from getting out of those hazards. And this session is going to be entirely different, which is going to talk about pipelining and data path. Now we have five stages in pipelining. As you know, the instruction fetch, instruction decode, instruction execution stage, memory access, and write back. Now this is the data path model that we have seen earlier in my previous sessions, as well as in multiple sessions we have seen this. This is a generalized data path model, whatever we have here. Now what is pipelining all about? Pipelining is all about, we talk about pipelining this way. Five instructions can be in execution at any point in time once the pipelining is all in picture. So pipelining should be visualized this way. It needs to start from left to right. The first component is the area where instruction is all available, and from instruction memory only we will fetch the instruction, and hence the stage is called as instruction fetch. And then the instruction should be decoded and the register content has to be read, and the second stage is called as instruction decode and register read. And the third stage is where the computation happens, which eventually means that we are executing in this stage. So we have the execution stage here. And when you come here, the fourth stage, if we have memory related access, that will happen here, and that is called memory access. And the fifth stage is called as write back. If you have to write back to a register, you will write back, or we need not do it there. So we have five stages, and all the five stages are realized in this picture very clearly. This is pipelining stages for you. Now, how does it look like? First instruction will start IF, ID, EX, MEM, WB. The second instruction will start when the first instruction goes to the decode state. The third instruction will start when the first instruction goes to the EX state. Fourth instruction will start when the first instruction is in the MEM state. Fifth instruction can start when the first instruction is in the write back state. So at any point in time, once the first instruction goes to the fifth stage, you can see that there will be multiple instructions that can get run in the pipeline. Please remember, IF is instruction fetch, ID is instruction decode, EX is instruction execution, MEM is memory access, W is write back, and that's what is exactly replicated in this picture. As we highlighted, it has to go from left to right. So please remember, washing the clothes will be this way. We will take the clothes, put it into the washing machine, we will wash, then we will move it onto the dryer, then we will fold. We will not fold it and then wash it. So it has to be from left to right. So remember it. But there is a catch. Will the left to right rule hold good for everything? No, there are some exceptions. What are the exceptions? When we have to write back the result, you get the result here, right? We may have to write back into the register. Then it is called as right to left. So when there is a branching operation, you might have to take right to left again. So the hold, the rule which is left to right will hold good for rest of all scenarios other than these two scenarios. And there is a ground rule that you need to realize and understand right now. The data flow will happen from left to right most normally, and it is normal, nothing will be influenced. The data flow can also happen from right to left when it is a write back or a branching related stuff. There would be some impact in the next pipeline instruction. For example, if branching is enabled, there would be a next instruction which would be called, which is not regularly in the pipeline, and it has to go to a different area. So when you write from right to left, when you move from right to left, there could be an impact in the total flow is the point. This you need to understand. Now, let us make it very clear with another picture. Pipelining has to be seen this way. Each instruction has got its own data path. This is its own data path. This is its own data path. This is its own data path. I told you earlier, please understand, I told you earlier. The point is simple. The pipelining will increase the throughput. It will not reduce the time frame of any particular instruction from execution. For example, if this needs 10 minutes, it will be only 10 minutes. If this needs 10 minutes, yes, it will be only 10 minutes. The overall time is what we can reduce, and we cannot reduce or we cannot make it efficient for single instruction. So please remember it. This is a very important view of pipelining that you need to understand. Now, another point is here. Now there are three different instructions here, LW, LW, LW. Three different instructions are here, and pipelining has to be done this way. The first instruction will start. Once the first instruction goes to the second stage, the second instruction will start the first stage. The third instruction will start the first stage. When the second instruction is in the second stage, likewise it will keep on going. And please remember, we need to have registers in between to hold the temporary values or to hold the values, because we may have to use the memory, we may have to use a sharing. I mean, the sharing will come into picture here. So you need an intermediary register stages for you to enable pipelining. What do you mean by this, sir? Very simple. I wash the clutch, I cannot directly put it into the dryer. I'll put it into a basket and then I'll move it onto the dryer. I dried the clutch, then I cannot right away put it into the folder, I mean the table. I need to put it into a basket, keep it on the table to fold it. And then I have folded it, I need to keep it in my room. I cannot directly throw it into the room. So I'll have a basket to have all this. And this temporary stuff, whatever we have in between, is called a register. You know what is a register? A register is nothing but a temporary storage medium where you can store data, and all the registers are made of flip-flops. Very simple, it can store the data temporarily. Let's remember that point. Now, let's get it better. Now, I have a register in between each stages. I have got four registers here. IF, ID, ID, EX, EX, MEM, MEM, WB. IF and ID is the register that is going to separate the pipelining stage instruction fetch and instruction decode. So this guy acts as a separator between these two stages. A very important point to understand, this pipelining registers is the register that is going to act as a separator. Please remember, it is a separator. It separates pipelining stages. Now ID EX, it is separating the stages between instruction decode and execution. EXMEM, it separates the stages from execution stage and then memory stage. MEM write back, it separates the MEM and write back stage. Now please understand, the naming convention should be this way only. It represents that this register belongs to both instruction memory side and this side as well, instruction decode side as well. That's the way we have named it. The naming convention is very important and it is very meaningful as well. Now, let's go to another aspect of it. How big or how wide should be this registers? It cannot be just 32 bit because it may flood the data from here. It may have to also handle data this side. So it may have to read from here. It may have to write into here. So it may have to hold the data for left and right. So it is just not 32 bit. It has to be 64 bits. So please remember that width of this pipeline registers is 64 bit. And that is it for now. So I have clearly explained you how the pipelining is visualized with the data path and what are all the registers that we keep in between, how do we name it, why do we need the registers, and all these things are clarified in this session. I hope I made it very clear. I'll come back to you in the next session with tracing the data path for any pipeline instruction very clearly. Thank you very much for following my channel. If you have any questions, you can post it across. If you have any suggestions, please go ahead. Subscribe if you like. Thank you.